I am not embarrassed nor ashamed. I am not embarrassed nor ashamed. You better ask for some of the enthusiasm you need. Sometimes we go into an experience and we feel bad because everybody's got, I'm going to ask for it. I'm going to need some agreement today. I came here with expectancy in my spirit. Some of y'all came with expectancy, but you didn't come with enthusiasm. I didn't expect something to happen and there's no fire there. Okay? I didn't preach that. I didn't come to preach that. All right? If Andrew, if you will please begin us with our first scripture. We're going to Acts, y'all. We're going to Acts. You know, the month of August is centered on the renewing of the spirit, the rebuilding of the temple this entire summer. We started with the physical body in June. We went on into the mind in July. And this, in August, our focus is on the spirit, rebuilding the spirit. So we're going to start out. We got a lot of scriptures today, but it's going to be in the same general area, so you don't have to worry about it. We're at Acts chapter 6. If you need a Bible today, then we've got some available for you. A lot of people use their phones now for apps. But if you'll make your way to Acts chapter 6, I don't expect anybody to be a Bible scholar. So if you'll make your way to the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts is right after the Gospels. Acts is right after the Gospels in the New Testament. As you make your way there, if you'll allow me to take us to the throne of grace through prayer. Lord, we bless you this day. God, and we honor you as the creator, the sustainer, the healer that you are. God, we thank you that we have placed you at the forefront of our minds, and you always lead us where we need to go, where we are supposed to go, and along the path that will bring us joy and that will bring us peace, God. Through your study of this word today, God, bring us peace. Bring us understanding, God. Lord, give us what our minds desired when we woke up this morning and chose this place to come and meet with you and your people, God. Lord, we thank you that your word never returns void. So everything that you cast out, Lord, everything you cast out will catch us. And if it's not applicable to us, God, Lord, maybe it's a word for our coworker tomorrow, God. Maybe it's a word for our community. It's a word for our family members, God. Or it's something that we're just supposed to marinate on and remember, Lord, in a timely way. So, God, we thank you that this word ministers to us in the here and now, not just in the by, God, that it is an on-time word that each one of us came here specifically today to receive. We just pledge all of these things, God, and we just allow it to just settle in our spirits, God, and to come out, Lord, when it's supposed to. In Jesus' name, amen?
Amen.
All right, so we are over here in Acts chapter 6. If you will look with me at verse 8. And just follow along as I read. Anybody heard of Stephen? Well, I'm going to introduce you to Stephen. Stephen is known as the first martyr of the faith. But we're going to pull out some things beyond his martyrdom, okay, today. The arrest of Stephen, if your Bible has subject titles. Verse 8, Stephen, full of grace and power, did great wonders and signs among the people. Then some of those who belonged to the synagogue of the freedmen, as it was called, Cyrenians, Alexandrians, and others of those from Cilicia and Asia, stood up and argued with Stephen. But they could not withstand the wisdom and the spirit with which he spoke. Then they secretly instigated some men to say, "We have heard him speak blasphemous words against Moses and God." They stirred up the people as well as the elders and the scribes. Then they suddenly confronted him, seized him, and brought him before the council. They set up false witnesses who said, "This man never stopped saying things against this holy place and the law. For we have heard him say that this Jesus of Nazareth will destroy this place and will change the customs that Moses handed on to us." And all those who sat in the council looked intently at him, and they saw that his face was like the face of an angel. So here's the reading of the word of God, amen?
Amen.
Let me point out a couple of things from this before we move on to our next set of scriptures. Look at verse 10. He said, "But they could not withstand the wisdom and the spirit with which he spoke." Anybody ever been in a situation where you were prejudged? I know I'm not talking about anybody in this room. Where you were prejudged based on any factor, race, gender, socioeconomic status, whether you had money, whether you didn't have money, your history, And your naysayers could not refute that there was something about you. They couldn't withstand the wisdom or the spirit with which you spoke. And it confounded them. How could you, of all people? Verse 11, it says, then they secretly instigated some men to say, anybody ever had somebody instigate?
Oh my God.
Y'all, I got to confess up here in the house of the Lord. Ooh, yeah. When I was growing up, and some of y'all would say I'm that now, I was the worst and the best instigator. Boy, I could instigate anything. Put me in the mix of it. You'll see it. I do it in a holy way now. I just laugh and joke about it. But I will instigate. I have been an instigator, boy. Put me in a scene with somebody. You over here. Y'all kind of going back and forth. But you could have resolved it if I had left my mouth out of it. You going to let him say that? I mean, he don't mean it. Don't matter. But you don't know what he meant by that. Why are you instigating? Because it's fun. I'm just an instigator. I've just been an instigator. But no, all jokes aside, have you really had somebody instigate against you?
Yes.
You were minding your own business, Joy. Mm-hmm. You were trying to do your own thing. Then you were just trying to make a change. The next thing you know, we got some people instigating. And they said, we've heard. Mm-hmm. Isn't it always something that they said?
Yeah.
We don't know who this they is. Well, you know, they say. We heard them speak blasphemous words against Moses and God. Look at verse 13. It says, they set up false witnesses. Y'all know false witnesses are straight up liars.
Oh, my God.
All right. They even got people lying on you. Now, lie. It says, this man never stopped saying things against the holy place and the law. And I'm going to show you what the real issue is. And there's a reason you're here today. For we have heard him say that this Jesus of Nazareth will destroy this place. Now look, they didn't have a problem with this place being destroyed as much as, look at this last part, and will change the customs that Moses handed on to us. People have less of a problem with you if you don't disturb the status quo. Their offense came in when they believed that he was going to change the customs, he's going to change the traditions, change what's customary, can't change what we've grown accustomed to, that Moses handed on to us. Now, this man, Jesus, arguably was the Son of God, whether you want to accept it or not. He was God incarnate. But before they received him, they let the customs and traditions of what they were used to get in the way of them receiving the new wine. Anybody ever been a friend? Because it's not you, it's never you, it's Keisha. Newcomers, we have this scapegoat that we call Keisha. When we really trying to say it's us, but we don't want to admit it's us because we're not at that point of accountability. So we blame Keisha. And we say it's Keisha. So Keisha, it's not really ready to let go of how things used to be. So we had a friend named Keisha, who, when you're trying to show her that things could be better, things could be different, she's more offended at you, not because you want what's best for her, but because you're trying to change how things used to be. No, I don't want to change that much. I'm used to it. Keisha, it's abusive. I'm used to it. Keisha, it dishonors you. I'm used to it, though. It would take too much to try to get used to a different set of circumstances, a different person, or a different way of life. I'm used to it, so now I'm going to blame you because you're trying to make me change from what I'm used to, even though it no longer serves me. Anybody ever had that situation before where you try to show somebody a different way of seeing something or living and they just don't want to accept it because not because it's not good, but because it's just against what they're used to?
Yes.
Tell somebody everybody won't get it.
Everybody won't get it.
If you will, go with me to Acts chapter 7. Acts chapter 7. We're just going to keep on going. But go to verse 8 for me. Acts chapter 7, verse 8. Acts chapter 7, verse 8. We have it up here. Then he gave him the covenant of circumcision. And so Abraham became the father of Isaac and circumcised him on the eighth day. And Isaac became the father of Jacob and Jacob of the 12 patriarchs. Stephen is telling history. This isn't, you're not like, what in the world's going on? Why is this in Acts? Stephen is telling the council history. And he's pointing out some things. So verse 9, the patriarchs, jealous of Joseph, sold him into Egypt, but God was with him and rescued him from all his afflictions and enabled him to win favor and to show wisdom when he stood before Pharaoh, king of Egypt, who appointed him ruler over Egypt and over all his household. In my study Bible, the footnote for this passage says, when Joseph's story, Stephen develops the theme of God's use of unlikely instruments for the salvation of Israel and Israel's rejection of those instruments. For anybody in this congregation who is being used of God as an instrument that is seemingly unlikely, understand that it will come with rejection. Understand that it will come with rejection. When I began preaching 8 years ago, teaching 9 years ago, I was an unlikely vessel. Very unlikely vessel. If I look back at some of the videos, some of y'all have been there with me from the beginning, I look the same. T-shirt, jeans, sneakers.
I need a robe.
That's why I couldn't receive. I need a robe. Unlikely vessel. Teaching truth, changing lives. Teaching truth and changing lives. But I can't tell you how many of the people who were uncomfortable. They came, they sat, but they were uncomfortable. Because how is this, at that time, what, 34, 35-year-old woman in t-shirts and jeans, 5'3¼, because when you're short, every quarter counts.
And a quarter, three-fourths, see?
Ask a short person, get ready. Come on. We don't have to round up or down. We want our quarter, our half and our three quarters. We're not trying to be greedy. I'm not 5'4", I'm 5'3¼, but I'm definitely not 5'3". I'm just saying. When your kids grow taller than you, you don't care. So what? I don't care. Taller than you now, mama, I don't care. 5'3¼". But that was an unlikely vessel. I was an unlikely vessel. So you're an unlikely vessel. When you go back home and you try to tell them something you learned here, or you're trying to explain to them how you're seeing God differently than you've ever seen God before, experiencing it. I love my old church. The tagline used to be, can't be explained, only experienced. And so you can't even put into words. They just stood here and said, she was asked, why are you doing this? Why are you running? I can't even really put it into words. I want to help people, but it's in the core of my being. You know, there's really no words I can really put to why I do what I do in Bible study. Nikki was talking about why people ask her with surprise, why do you go out every other weekend, don't do outreach, and you feed people who might not even appreciate what? I can't explain to you. I just have to. I don't even feel obligated to. If I don't do it, I'm going to feel weird the rest of the week until I do it again. It's a part of who I am. But why you? You don't look like the type. Because there's a type. For everything that you do, believe, there's a type for it. And so there's a rejection that can come with it. Don't let that stop you. Tell somebody, everybody won't get it. Everybody won't get it. Over in Acts, you're still in Acts. Turn over to verse 20. Verse 20 of the same chapter. Verse 20, and it reads, at this time, Moses was born, and Stephen's still telling the story, and he was beautiful before God. For 3 months, he was brought up in his father's house, and when he was abandoned, Pharaoh's daughter adopted him and brought him up as her own son. Those of you who grew up in the faith, yep, this is a very familiar story. So Moses was instructed in all the wisdom of the Egyptians and was powerful in his words and deeds. When he was 40 years old, it came into his heart to visit his relatives, the Israelites. When he saw one of them being wronged, he defended the oppressed man and avenged him by striking down the Egyptian. He supposed that his kinfolk would understand that God through him was rescuing them, but they did not understand. The next day he came to some of them as they were quarreling and tried to reconcile them, saying, "Men, you are brothers. Why do you wrong each other?" Anybody ever thrown anything up in your face? Here we go. But the man who was wronging his neighbor pushed Moses aside, saying, "Who made you a ruler and judge over us? Do you want to kill me as you killed the Egyptian yesterday?" When he was saving a person's life. When he heard this, Moses fled and became a resident alien in the land of Midian. There he became the father of two sons. So ends the reading of the word of God. Amen. Amen. Y'all. Verse 22, it says, "So Moses was instructed in all the wisdom of the Egyptians and was powerful in his words and deeds." In verse 25, he said he supposed that his kinsfolk would understand that God through him was rescuing them, but they did not understand. Anybody ever went on? You went to college, you got your master's or not, or you got a better job, and you did this. You did this to help better the family as a unit. You put yourself out in activism, or you put yourself out in service, or you put and it seemed as though the people that you were trying to help would understand. But somehow they saw this as you being better than them, or trying to be better than them. So he said, "I thought you would understand." Now I know that it seems like I'm comparing murder to your accomplishments in life, but put yourself back in this era of time. He recognized that even though he grew up raised as an Egyptian, he was really an Israelite. And he saw one of his brethren being oppressed by someone, and he felt he needed to come in and save his kinfolk. And so he did what he thought he could do. He ended up having the Egyptian killed. And he thought that there would be gratitude, even though it did still bother him. He thought there would be gratitude that he had saved a fellow Israelite's life. So when he goes back and he tries to make peace between two Israelites who are fighting, they throw it up in his face. "Well, who are you? Basically, you murderer? Are you judging us? Are you telling us how we..." And so he thought, "But surely y'all recognized that I was simply trying to save our brother's life." Everybody won't get it, y'all. Everybody won't get your intentions. Everybody won't get your heart. Everybody won't get your drive. Everybody won't get your reasons. And what did he do? He went and just became, and he just fell back. He went to a whole other land. He fell back. How many of y'all ever just fallen back because it seemed like nobody understood that you were really trying? "I'm just trying to help. I'm not trying to be better than anybody. I'm not trying to do this for myself. I'm just trying to help." But you know what? You don't recognize that, so I'm just going to fall back. How about that? And I'm telling you, don't fall back. Everybody won't get it. Everybody won't get it. Everybody's not designed to get it. Everybody doesn't have the capacity that you have, and nobody else has been given your vision for your purpose and for your mission. Everybody won't get it. Now let's keep going on. Your same chapter, verse 34. Stephen's still telling the story. Acts 7, verse 34. Andrew, do you have that? Verse 34. He said, I have surely seen the mistreatment of my people who are in Egypt, and have heard their groaning, and I have come down to rescue them. Come now, I will send you to Egypt. It was this Moses whom they rejected when they said, "Who made you ruler and judge?" And whom God now sent as both ruler and liberator through the angel who appeared to him in the bush. He led them out, having performed wonders and signs in Egypt, at the Red Sea, and in the wilderness for 40 years. The same man that they threw up in his face, "Who do you think you are?" Our ruler became just that, their ruler and leader. Verse 37 says, "This is the Moses who said to the Israelites, 'God will raise up a prophet from you, for you from your own people, and he raised me up as he raised me up.' He is the one who was in the congregation in the wilderness with the angel who spoke to him at Mount Sinai and with our ancestors, and he received living oracles to give to us. Our ancestors were unwilling to obey him. Instead, they pushed him aside, and in their hearts, they turned back to Egypt." Did y'all see that last part? They didn't literally go back to Egypt, but in their hearts, they went back to that mental state of bondage over listening to and following the liberator. Don't be surprised. Don't be surprised. Dana, don't be surprised when there are members of our own community who still have a mindset of bondage even as you're trying to liberate us through your representation. There's no need to get disappointed about it, upset about it. Just know it's going to happen. Why are you troubling the waters, Dana? Why are you rocking the boat, Dana? We've come so far. You trying to ask a little too much. Tiffany, why do you keep trying to make the way its own institution, its own community? There are churches that are not opening up to let us sit in their back pew. Why do we need our own churches? I mean, they're not letting us come in and we can't serve yet, but at least we can become a member. They won't christen our children and definitely won't marry us, but at least we can come and sit there in the pew and they'll take our tithes and offerings, but they won't. Why do you keep pushing the envelope and making sure that there's an actual LGBT, founded? A place where all people can come, whether they're gay, straight, transgender, black, white, poor, rich. So why do you keep coming to this place that's predominantly gay? Also, why do you keep coming to this church that's predominantly female? There are places you can go. There are other places you can go. Why are you pushing the envelope? Y'all see what I'm talking about? There will be people who will say, I'd just rather stay in this box and keep these blinders on because we've already made enough strides. Why you keep trying to push? You're going to make them, whoever them is, mad at us. Am I lying to her? You make them, they allowed us to have all this many rights. Why are you pushing? Everybody won't get it. Everybody won't get it. Why does your church have to go out there? There are different, there are transitions. There are churches that give food. There are places that they can go. Why do y'all have to go out there? That's what they say. Y'all so little. The big churches do that. No, they don't. That's why we're out there. They don't. There are some who do. But when you go to the United Way and you look at the roster of people that are helping and who are doing our work, there are little ministries and there are little churches that are doing it. There are little agencies and there are companies that are doing it. Small companies, a law firm here and a CPA there. Everybody won't understand why you do what you do, why you have the heart that you have, but you don't have to answer to them. You answer to your spirit.
That's right.
They pushed him aside, and he ended up being the one that liberated them. Everybody won't get it. So Stephen is telling them that Israel rejected Moses. And he did all of that, indicting Israel and telling them, here you are again. This is the same council now to connect history. This is the same council. Stephen is standing in front of the same council that arranged for Jesus' execution. The same council that ordered Peter and John to stop teaching in Jesus' name. Stephen was bold and brave. And he still told them, now look at what you've done. If we continue in Acts, look at verse 51 and 52. Oh, Stephen just really, he was really giving it to him. He said, you stiff-necked people. I like that. Young people think y'all be telling people off. Nah, you're not. Nah, not until you say, you stiff-necked people. You scumbucket. You scatterwag. You stiff-necked people. He said, uncircumcised in heart and ears, you are forever opposing the Holy Spirit just as your ancestors used to do. Which of the prophets did your ancestors not persecute? Stephen was going in. He was like, you know what? If y'all gonna kill me, I'm gonna give you a reason. Which one of the prophets did your ancestors not persecute? They killed those who foretold the coming of the righteous one, and now you have become his betrayers and murderers. Let's look at this phrase for one moment. We've got a little bit of time. Uncircumcised in heart and ears. Andrew, keep that up, please. Uncircumcised in heart and ears. Circumcision. Circumcision. Everybody in here know what circumcision is? All right. Clinically, you brought your kids, you know what to expect. Clinically, to cut off the foreskin of the penis of a boy or a man for Israelites to choose. Now, this is the biblical definition. Oh, she got to say, I'm not ready for that. I didn't sign the waiver. I didn't sign the waiver. All right, circumcision. The biblical definition, to cut off the foreskin from the penis of a boy or a man. But Israelites or Jews, it was a mark to show that a man agreed to obey the things that God wants him to do. A mark of a good and clean spirit. That was under Judaism, or as far as the Israelites were concerned, historical Judaism. That's the good biblical commentary. That's the good footnote definition of circumcision. But can we go deep? No pun intended. This is just going bad on all accounts. This is going bad on all accounts. This would end up in some kind of anniversary blooper, I'm sure. But anyway, y'all know I say that anyway. This just happened to be a bad subject, but whatever. Let's get back on track. Back on track. We understood what the religious commitment meant with circumcision. See, but when you look at the clinical procedure, there is an exposure that's taking place, okay? And you are cutting away any ability to cloak, any ability to hide, just go with me, all right? Figuratively, you're exposing, you're cutting away. And it's funny because when you think of the uncircumcised heart, ears, eyes, or whatever, when people want to cover and hide or cover and conceal, they often think that they're protecting themselves. When in fact, biologically, physiologically, after you circumcise a male, he's less prone to infection. Because of all the bacteria and all the things that can hide in that flesh that's covering it. Okay, I'm gonna leave that there for those who did well in English. And an interpretation. So we understand that this act of circumcision was a commitment, but it was also a process that exposed the young man or exposed the person. Now, so for Stephen to accuse them of being uncircumcised in heart and ears, he's accusing them not just of ignorance, y'all, but blatant disobedience. You see, an uncircumcised heart is one that, for whatever reason, has not been open to the things of God, either by way of exposure or commitment. Therefore, the individual doesn't even recognize the things of God. Let me say that again because somebody missed it. The uncircumcised heart hasn't been open to the things of God. Therefore, the individual doesn't even recognize the things of God. You can't recognize something that you've never been exposed to. Let me say that again. You cannot recognize something that you've never been exposed to. In other words, I've not dedicated my heart to the Lord, therefore I'm still ignorant to the Holy Spirit and most things concerning the kingdom. Okay? It says that the things of the Spirit can recognize the Spirit. Only the things of the Spirit will know the Spirit. Going a bit deeper, uncircumcised ears, on the other hand, refuse to even hear the things of God in order to ever understand them. Now let me break that down for you. Because we got the uncircumcised heart over here and the uncircumcised ears over here. The uncircumcised heart has never been open to the things of God, exposed to the things of God, so it doesn't recognize the things of God. The uncircumcised ear doesn't even want to hear it. So it'll never understand. Okay? Now, faith comes by hearing, And hearing comes by the word of God. Faith comes by hearing. And hearing comes by the word of God. So if I am, this is for my note takers, if I am willing to listen to the word of God, I'm not just talking about evangelism, I'm not talking about going out and proselytizing people and getting people saved and all this good stuff. If I am willing to listen to the word of God, I will develop the ability to hear, which will build my faith. Listen to that. If I am willing to listen to the word of God, and see, we've already talked about this, I believe it was last year, we talked about the word of God, was it 2 years ago, 2 Decembers ago, when the entire series during Christmas time was the word? The word was the gospel. The word is freedom. The word is understanding that God is within you and not just out there in the atmosphere, that there's a God in you that you answer to, that you get into relationship with, so that it can guide you and not 3-4 friends. That the word was freedom from rules and laws of religion, that the word, that Jesus was the Logos and was the word and came to free you from that so that you can have a relationship directly with God and the God within you. So if I'm listening to the word of God, which frees me and allows me to have direct relationship with God because I hear God within myself, I will develop the ability to hear. And that builds my faith. Y'all need sharing the experience I just had at the gym. As I was recovering from my back injury, I went back to the gym, I think it was Tuesday. And one of the things that I do, to get from UE, is at the end of my workout, I go into the sauna. I go into the sauna. I love it. I used to play with it, And then when Eve said she did it every time that she worked, I'm like, let me just try to get into this, you know. And so I go into the sauna after every workout, and I detox. You know, I release. And I release through my sweat. I release. And I even tell myself, you're releasing. You're releasing. You're lifting off. You're releasing. And so I always make that a ritual of mine so that it don't even feel right if I don't. And so I'm in the sauna. See, in this particular YMCA, the sauna is small. It's not as big as the one downtown. So it's small, and it's like an L shape. And you've got a second level. It's like an L, you know, sitting on. You can sit. I go high. And since I'm 5'3¼", I can lay completely flat. From wall to wall. You know, my little feet and my head, and I'm right there on the bench. And so I'm laying there. And I'm, you know, detoxing and meditating. And then there's this young girl that comes in. And I've seen her when we were working out. I saw her on the floor doing her little young thing that I could do at some point. Whatever. And, you know, back when I wasn't 41, am I 42? No, I'm still 41. See, you know you're old when you forget how old you are. God darn it. So when I wasn't 41, I could do that stuff, you know, and she's going over here, and she'll do that little thing, and she'd go over here and get back on the bike. And she'd go over here and do that thing and get back on the bike. You see, I was bothered because I could see her routine. I mean, I memorized her routine and look at her. So in she comes to my song. And I'm laid out, and I just, something got a little uncomfortable at that point. And so I was like, well, let me sit up, or, you know, let me try to reconfigure, you know. And she sat down, and see that she couldn't get right either and stuff, and where she was sitting, and, you know, it's a little darker dim in there. And so finally, I got up and I sat in the lotus position. And, you know, that's cross-legged, you know. So I'm in the lotus position, and I got comfortable. And at that moment, she was on a lower level, she got up next to me, and she got in a lotus position. And at that moment, I can't even... It can't be explained, only experienced. There was connecting of our spirits right there in that moment. I know the girl had to be all of 17, Caucasian. Oh, here I am, 41, black lady. I know I had to look at her. I mean, we just don't meditate in a lotus position like that. And there's not a lot of us who do that. So there might have been, I don't know if it was hard for her or not. But our spirits connected. She got up on the same level with me, same position. And I said, I feel her. And I could tell she was drawn to me. And so I said, you know what, I'm going to take control of this moment. Because it was me. I set the president of the atmosphere at that time. I might be a little too hooky spooky for some of y'all. Because I know this is not necessarily Christian, but it's spiritual. Come on now. And so I'm sitting here in lotus position. She's in lotus position. I ain't even told my wife this. She went like, what's going on? And I said it right here in my mind. I said, I give her my wisdom and I'll receive some of her youth. Amen. somebody and they suck all your energy. And you're acting like, I'm just, you know, now I'm drained. Forget that, bump that. I said, because I'm empathic as well to a degree. I said, no, I'm about to take control, because if there's going to be a spiritual exchange, I'm going to dictate what it's going to be. I give you my wisdom, you give me your youth. And I sat there until I felt that spirit released me, and then I got up and walked out. I may never see this girl again. We didn't have to know each other. In that moment, we knew each other in the spirit. She got what she needed, I got what I needed. My back has felt better since then. And I pray that she feels a little wiser. But whatever she needed, the way I need, Waymakers, I need for us to keep on, just keep on getting outside the box. Getting outside the box. Getting outside the box. And so he says, and here, like I just told you, if I'm willing to listen to the word of God, that I'm free, that I'm not bound by any rules, I'll develop the ability to hear, to feel, to experience, to pick up on things like that. And that will build my faith. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing comes by the word of God. A circumcised heart and circumcised ears, y'all, are ones that are so open and committed to the workings of the Lord that they can just sense the Spirit of God. I can sense the Spirit of God. And don't think that's always some good, great feeling. You can sense people's hurt. You can sense their yearning. You can sense their loneliness. So when you say, I want to be used of God, I want to connect with God, don't think that's always going to be the yummy, good feeling stuff. I just always want to feel the presence of the angels. And no, honey, that means that you're on a deeper level too, spiritually. So now I can feel your pain. I can feel that you just need a kind word, or you just need a smile. And I connect with you, and I'm willing to give that smile, just a smile, to you, because that's what your spirit feels that you need. I just said earlier, and I'm about to close. I just said earlier, uncircumcised ears refuse to even hear the things of God in order to ever understand them. Now I'm going to go out on a limb here, okay? Before I close, I'm going to sit down, I'm going to leave y'all in all kinds of mess, and I'm just going to sit down and leave and run out the building. Okay? Because now that you have ears to hear, there is something that I just want to mess you up about. Amen. You're like, oh, Lord, here we go. It ain't got nothing to do with nothing. I'm just using bad grammar, okay? It has nothing to do with nothing. And if you understand English, you understand the double negative means it has everything to do with everything. I'm so smart. 1 Corinthians 14. Gifts of prophecy and tongues. And I don't know why God is telling me, go ahead, just blow them out the water. For some of you who've never understood this, heard this before, people who have been with me a long time have already heard this. But he says, if you got circumcised ears, then you're willing to hear some things of God so that you can understand them. And so I'm just going to throw this out here in your spirit again. It has nothing to do with anything. It has everything to do with everything. He said here, pursue love. I'm going to read for a minute. Strive for the spiritual gifts, and especially that you may prophesy. For those who speak in a tongue do not speak to other people but to God, for nobody understands them, since they are speaking mysteries in the spirit. God gave me a revelation. First of all, by research, that word prophesy in the New Testament, in the New Covenant, I've taught this before. In the Old Covenant, prophesy was the foretelling, okay? Prophecy and a prophet was someone who foretold something. It came, and especially the major prophets, your Isaiahs, your Jeremiahs, and even your Jonah. They would come. They were the messengers who would send warnings. They were the messengers who would send good tidings. They were the ones who would tell you, you know, get your stuff together. God is going to smite you. Right, Elder? Going to smite you. Excuse me, Deacon. That was Deacon's word, smite you. Going to smite you. See, but in the New Covenant, a prophet or those who prophesy are the ones who spread the good news. Those were the preachers. The prophets were the preachers. The pastors weren't the preachers. See, that's a myth. That's something that we've already gotten wrong. A pastor was a caretaker, a shepherd. Pastors aren't really preachers. We've just blended the two. The prophet is the preacher, because they're the ones that are spreading the good news and the free you and all this stuff. That's what the prophecy is. And so now we got people who are operating under Old Covenant, Old Testament man. and gifts trying to tell you your future like little Miss Cleo or something. And you need to tell them, sweetheart, that was in Isaiah and Jeremiah's time. Now, if you call yourself a prophet, then you need to be breaking chains. You need to be healing people, and you need to be telling them about the good news. But that's not even what I came to tell you about today. I need to understand, he said, especially that you may prophesy, especially that you may preach, especially that you may share the good news. Remember when he said, go ye therefore and teach all nations. He was talking to people who are willing to go and prophesy. He said, for those who speak in a tongue, do not speak to other people, but to God. I need you to know something you may not know. That word tongue right there, if you look at it in the Greek, it simply says language. Okay? Those who speak in a tongue do not speak to other people but to God, but nobody understands them since they are speaking mysteries in the spirit. Let me put you in this in the context, all right? Let me put this in the context. Because there are people back in that time, they were so secluded and so as nations. The nations, each nation had their own language, okay? And so they didn't mix. They took that seriously now. They did not mix. So there were very few bilingual people. To be bilingual was a huge, big deal. In fact, they looked at you kind of mysteriously that you knew other languages. All right? So they were very much so. If you live in England, you spoke English. You lived in Japan, you spoke Japanese. That's what you spoke. So if you came over, you could speak both languages. We're looking at you like, what are you up to? Or that you were special. There was something that God created. So anyway, he says, so for those who speak in a tongue, they do not speak to other people but to God. For nobody understands them since they are speaking mysteries in the spirit. They felt as though bilingual people were like gypsies. I mean, just mystical people. Mystical people. And so understand the context. It says, verse 3, on the other hand, those who prophesy speak to other people for their upbuilding and encouragement and consolation, because their frame of reference is only that you use our language to talk to people. You use the language of the homeland to talk to people. So anybody outside of that, they're speaking in a different language or a different tongue. Prophecy happens within our language. It's ignorant, but it's different. Those who speak in a tongue build up themselves, but those who prophesy build up the church. Now, I would like all of you to speak in tongues, but even more to prophesy. One who prophesies is greater than the one who speaks in tongues, unless someone interprets so that the church may be built up. Now, let me help you out. Because for a very long time, we have thought that this whole speaking in tongues was this wild, mystical thing that only Pentecostal, Apostolic, and Holiness people did. Yeah, exactly, Nate. Only did that. And they would do that, yes, and like I said, yes, a couple Sundays ago, I said, yeah, I can do that too. I can do a little prayer language, I can order my sasakala, whatever, I can do that too. You know? But oh my God, when I look back at Acts chapter 2, come on now. Hey, when I look back at Acts chapter 2, and it's using the exact same word for tongue as it did for language when the Holy Spirit came down, some of y'all said, And it said that when the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place, and suddenly from heaven there came like a rush of a violent wind. Now, y'all also have to understand that during this time of antiquity, there were a lot of things that simply weren't explained. And there were a lot of things that were attributed to mystical, mystery, and stuff that people just could not explain. It says, suddenly from heaven there came a sound like a rush of violent wind and filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as a fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages. Depending on your Bible, it says tongues. As the Spirit gave them ability. Now, there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem, and at the sound, the crowd gathered. If you go down, it says, verse 7, amazed and astonished, they asked, are not all these who speak in Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in our own native language? That doesn't sound like some Orabasasakalayo stuff. That sounds like somebody who hears their language being spoken. I've talked about this before, and I've said that there are some of us, even now nowadays who just have this knack for learning another language. I'm not one of them. My son is not one of them. Andrew took 1 year of Spanish. He said, I will never again. Struggle the whole time. I'm not doing it. I'm English and I'm barely that. So I'm not doing Spanish. I took French in high school and in college, and you couldn't tell me what. I remember comme ci, comme ça, and merci. That's all I got. That's all I got for you. That's all I've got for you. I don't remember anything else. I can pronounce words and names in anybody's language, but I cannot, I'm not one of those people. But then there are some of y'all that can pick up a language like that, 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 that. It's totally immersion, just going to a country and leave you there a good 5 days, and you come out speaking with a. When you can do something like that, Shay, people would see you as somebody that God must have given you a spiritual gift of tongues. Not all of us, but I can go into a place, and next thing you know, I can take the gospel to this country. Can y'all see? We get caught up in the foolish. I was wrapped up in it too. I was wrapped up in it too. But I'm going to tell you the truth today. It is much more of a testament to God when I can go in a place and begin to speak like the natives speak and give the word of truth and of freedom of God. That's why they said when you come into a congregation, all you're doing is speaking in tongues. They don't understand you. You're not honoring God. That's why they said you're going to have an interpreter. Now you're looking back on all those times you sat in somebody's church and then somebody stood up and said, oh, and then somebody else stood up and said, thus saith the Lord. That's why everybody looking at them sideways. That's why your spirit didn't agree with it. Because somebody said, this is some foolishness. But imagine if somebody who had Shay's gift came in here and there was somebody else who was sent here from Ecuador and they had a message for the way. And we couldn't understand what they were speaking because people from Ecuador speak Spanish. Maybe 4 of y'all would get it. But the rest of us sitting there like, it sounds powerful. But I don't know what they're saying. But Shay, who has the gift of interpretation and just happens to pick up easily on Spanish, says, I know what they say. They said that God is right now in our midst. And do you see how more powerful that was and how you can trust that now? Because you recognize that is a language. I know that's a language. I don't understand it, but I know that's a language. That ain't no roll up a bus, he rolled up in a Honda. I'm freeing you today. I'm freeing you today. Because that's why it never resonated with you. And you thought you were a subpar Christian because you didn't speak it. There's no reason I should be able to get up here and just roll off like that. When I'm supposed to be filled with the Holy Ghost and saying this stuff. But all the people I can reach if I have this ability to learn a language just that fast and to interpret what a messenger says. So now when you have that in context, they said here in verse 8, and how is it that we hear each of us in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, and parts of Libya, coming to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs. In our own languages, we hear them speaking about God, deeds of power. How crazy did that look if that many languages were being spoken from the disciples? All these people are gathered around. Yes, I'm sure it sounded like, yes, it sounded like that. But there was somebody in the audience who said, wait a minute, I heard English. And they're listening. Wait a minute, I heard French. Wait a minute, hold on, I heard Arabic. What are they saying to me? You hear what I'm saying? I hear Portuguese. Do you understand how powerful that is for God and the message of the kingdom? And so back over there in Corinthians, he said to them, and you know Paul, I love Paul. But he says, I speak in more tongues than all of y'all. He's so arrogant. But I would still give that you prophesy. Because unless there was an interpreter there, then it's all futile. People will come. Y'all remember that passage? You'll come into the church and they'll think you're all mad. And somebody will say, they drank new wine. And he'll say, no, it's just the beginning of the morning. And Peter began to tell them what's really going on. Those with an ear, let them hear. Those with an ear, let them hear. You see how I had to take it through that whole exercise of being willing to have an uncircumcised mind and heart and ears before you can hear something like that. Because for some people, y'all know that would rock the core of their entire denomination. It really would. That would rock their entire denomination. Because if you didn't have an ear to hear something like that, you'd probably walk up out of here and never come back. I'd be a false prophet, the heretic that I proudly claim to be. And you'd reject it. Still beating yourself up because I can't speak in that tongue. All the while, you can speak five different languages and you're the real person gifted with tongues or interpretation. Elder, can you come on up? Amen, God. Amen, God, for truth. Amen, God, for the ear to hear truth, for us to be able to continuously learn. Can you all greet the woman of God? Amen.